The 1950s were a very eventful decade in America. The post-World War II boom was in full effect, and the United States found itself with a roaring economy, a formidable military, and a population that was rapidly growing. All in all, things were looking pretty good, so much so that British Prime Minister Winston Churchill remarked, "America, at the moment, stands at the summit of the world." Things weren't all roses and rainbows, however, as the Cold War came about in this era, and the very real threat of it turning into an outright boots-on-the-ground conflict was very real. The 50s also marked the height of the atomic age, which began in 1945 following the war, when uranium and nuclear power rose to prominence as a means of providing energy, creating weaponry, and also made it into the mainstream culture, with nuclear-themed toys, TV shows and films, and even live viewings of nuclear bomb detonations, which became a tourist attraction just 65 miles outside of Las Vegas, earning it the moniker Atomic City, USA. On today's episode, we explore this fascinating era in American history, when tensions ran high with the Soviet Union and citizens became aware of both the threats and the intrigue of uranium and nuclear power. Welcome to the Atomic Age on Commodity Culture. The nuclear bombs dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki in World War II were really the catalyst for the American public's interest in uranium and nuclear. I covered that bombing in more detail in our uranium episode, but suffice to say, the devastation it unleashed was unimaginable, with the total number of casualties being somewhere around 200,000 unfortunate souls. Nonetheless, President Truman, who ordered the bombs dropped, explained to the American public that such an extreme measure was needed to end the war, and whether you agree with that or not, most Americans seemed to go along with it. In fact, only a short amount of time after the bombs were dropped, theater shows with atom bomb dancers and bars serving up atomic cocktails came onto the scene, bringing wider public recognition and generally putting a positive spin on a very tragic event. General Mills even included an atomic bomb ring in their cereal boxes. Now that's fun for the whole family. More interesting, and perhaps alarming, was the Gilbert U-238 Atomic Energy Lab toy, which contained actual uranium-bearing ore samples and radioactive chemicals. As the full dangers of handling such materials weren't widely known at the time, the product was targeted at children, to help them learn about the wonders of nuclear energy, with a slogan proclaiming, "This is the closest man has come to watching the atom," while also warning, "Users should not take ore samples out of their jars, for they tend to flake and crumble, and you would run the risk of having radioactive ore spread out in your laboratory." Mercifully, the Atomic Energy Lab, which Radar magazine dubbed the world's most dangerous toy in 2006, sold less than 5,000 units. This era also gave rise to the popularity of radiation and nuclear energy in comic books, with one of the first atomic superheroes, Atomic Man, who gained his powers after experimenting with uranium following the bombing of Hiroshima and Nagasaki. The experimentation leads to his body transforming and gaining resistance to lethal levels of radiation, along with super strength and even mind control capabilities. It really is fascinating to see the breadth of both heroes and villains whose origin stories were sparked by exposure to radiation in the years that followed. Spider-Man, the Hulk, the Fantastic Four, Dr. Octopus, and many more all have radiation to thank for their superpowers.
Because in one moment of history-making violence, nature, mad, rampant, wrought its most awesome creation. For born in that swirling inferno of radioactive dust, were things so horrible, so terrifying, so hideous, there is no word to describe them.
The atomic bomb had perhaps the most influence on films of the 1950s. Imaginations of script writers in the science fiction and horror genres were sparked by the myriad possibilities of including nuclear explosions and the radiation they produce into their stories. That trailer clip was from the 1954 movie Them, when monstrous ants born in a nuclear explosion threatened to overtake the world. Another film that played on the atomic trope was Attack of the Crab Monsters, where intrepid scientists venture to a strange island filled with radiation, only to find, you guessed it, crab monsters. The effects of the atom bomb on cinema weren't restricted to America. The country that was victim to it, Japan, even got involved with the original Godzilla film. A hydrogen bomb test in the ocean off the coast of Japan is the trigger that wakes the reptile behemoth from his slumber and begins his reign of terror on the country. Producer Tomoyuki Tanaka confirmed this influence when he stated, "The theme of the film, from the beginning, was the terror of the bomb. Mankind had created the bomb, and now nature was going to take revenge on mankind."
The moments tick away as we await the bomb and the fireball. The light flash and the heat or thermal wave, then the blast wave.
In 1951, the United States began conducting nuclear bomb tests in Nevada. These extremely terrifying test blasts would incinerate and destroy buildings set up in the area, but surprisingly, this made Nevada a popular tourist destination as people flocked to the area to engage in so-called dawn parties. As many of these tests were held in the early morning hours, casino goers who had been up all night partying and testing their luck could cap off their evening by watching one of the most destructive weapons known to mankind detonate in the distance. I tell ya, people in those days were just built different. The reason for these tests was, of course, not merely for the amusement of drunken gamblers, but due to the ever-growing threat presented by political tensions with the Soviet Union that led to the Cold War. This war based on ideology, capitalism versus communism, saw both the US and the Soviet Union in an arms race to develop nuclear weapons, and questions on how to use and control their use became a centerpiece of the conflict. With that in mind, these tests were designed to determine the impact of nuclear weapons on different environments and structures, including military equipment, as well as testing the strength and efficiency of new nuclear weapons and studying the effects of nuclear fallout. All done in the name of American military might, and of course, self-defense in the event that Russia would push the big red button and send nukes flying into the US of A.
Dum-dum, deedle-dum-dum, there was a turtle by the name of Bert, and Bert the turtle was very alert. When danger threatened him, he never got hurt. He knew just what to do. He'd duck and cover, duck and cover.
Fear sparked in the general public by the possibility of a nuclear missile or bomb being targeted at America led to the now somewhat laughable duck and cover nuclear safety video that was popularized in schools. Incredibly, this film was presented as an official safety guideline right from the Federal Civil Defense Administration and in consultation with the Safety Commission of the National Education Association. How the military and school bureaucrats came to the conclusion that ducking under a school desk would somehow increase chances of survival in the event of a nuclear explosion is beyond me, but nonetheless, these videos were accompanied by drills done in the classrooms, which ended up spreading a lot of fear and anxiety. Try to disguise a situation of life and death with an adorable turtle all you want, but the fact is, the children were far from amused by the situation. One wonders if it would have been better to not run these drills at all, considering the apparent futility of the instructions they gave and the potential psychological impact on both the students and their families. Some have claimed that ducking under a desk could potentially help reduce the risk of injury from a nuclear bomb going off far in the distance, so it's possible the effort wasn't entirely in vain, but thankfully, the dreaded moment when the maneuver had to be used never came. The atomic age in America is something that's always fascinated me, a real piece of cultural history that still resonates throughout popular culture today. Throughout the ages, video games, music, television and film, politics, and yes, even energy production through uranium and nuclear have been influenced in one way or another by this unique era. You've got to admit, it has a sort of quirky romantic charm, just the theater of it all. Sipping an atomic cocktail in Vegas, as you watch the sunrise, along with a nuclear mushroom cloud that lights up the sky with a blinding flash, before heading home to pour cereal for the kids, while they delight over their free atomic bomb ring, included in the box. White picket fences, Frank Sinatra's hit, Accidents Will Happen, playing on the radio, and the threat of it all being wiped away by Russian nukes at any moment. If that's not living on the edge, I don't know what is. Commodity culture covers the history, culture, and science behind commodities and natural resources. If you guys like this shorter form content, like this episode, please do let me know in the comments and I'll be sure to make more, along with my regular feature-length documentaries, and do feel free to check out the one on uranium, which is my most popular video to date. I'd also like to give a shout out to the Atomic Heritage Foundation, because their article, Atomic Culture, formed the basis of the inspiration for this episode. Please be sure to subscribe and hit the bell notifications so you're always notified of the latest episodes.